continue your conversation. That's Barry. You guys just turn the sound up if people are still talking. That's a rowdy song, okay, and we're just going to do it in a very rowdy way, so just have fun with it. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore.
On rescuer, you're going to holler.
Are you going to holler? What if I don't?
Oh,
maybe I'll let you holler. I'll let you holler.
I'll holler.
You never know what I'm going to do. All right. He's our rescuer.
Hey!
He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound.
Hey!
Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. There is good news for the captive.
Good news for the shame. Good news for the one who walked away.
There is good news for the doubter, unrelenting and unfair. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer.
Hey!
He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forever.
For the one
the world ignores. He is pasture for the weary, rest for those who stand dry. Oh, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, and the life. He's our rescuer.
Hey!
He's our fearless, come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. Come and be chainless. So come and be chainless. Come and be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. There is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. Now I'd like to ask you all to stand up, please, if you can. And we'll do this chorus one more time. He's our rescuer.
Hey!
He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound.
Hey!
Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin. How sweet the sound.
Hey!
Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer.
Thank you. You may be seated. We are really glad that you're here this morning. Sorry about having you get up out of your seats like you're some sort of strangers in this house. You are very welcome here this morning. We're so glad that you are here. And we're glad to be the company of the rescued.
Hello.
Oh, we get a little rowdy once in a while when the Lord brings it to our attention how just exactly how much we have to thank Him for that rescue, that incredible rescue, snatched from the fire and made whole, made complete in His sight. Amen. Made absolutely, made Christ. We're seated in Christ in the heavenly places. Hallelujah. This next song, we want to turn that reality into a prayer as we ask God to lift us up. Amen. It is two pages, guys, so I do need to have both pages showing. At least that well, I know what song I'm, what chord I'm supposed to be playing. Anyway, I play this guitar with a great deal more passion than talent. Those of you who are guitarists, you've already realized that. Anyway.
Like a little child, Jesus told me to come, and the Father lifts me up to heaven, up to home. Father, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Father, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name.
Sorry.
If I be lifted up from the earth, Jesus said, I will call every person unto me. If I die to self, Jesus told me I will live. Crucified with Jesus, I want to be. Jesus, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Jesus, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. High up above all power and all kings, there is a throne room where the faithful sing. Holy, holy, holy to the Lamb that was slain. Through the Holy Spirit I call upon your name. Spirit, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Spirit, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Jesus, lift me up, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Father, lift me up, hallelujah, holy is your name. Father, lift me up,
This week, several hundred million people did something that they don't usually do during the week. They went to church on Wednesday. and Lent began. This is the first Sunday in Lent. For those of you who observe in that particular way, we respect and honor that tradition. And there may be certain things that you're not used to doing, like having communion during Lent and those sorts of things that we do in our tradition. It's not out of disrespect. And we do honor those traditions. So I don't know what you may have given up if you are observing Lent. I don't know what you may have given up. I had planned to give up church. And then Jim hurt his hand, so I had... Anyway. Father, we thank you, we bless you, and we praise you. Lord Jesus, we welcome you here, that you would be honored in our presence, that we would lift you up through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we acknowledge you are God in our midst. You live within us, and you bring and offer both Father and Son to us through your operations, through your work in our lives. Lord Jesus, thank you for your Spirit. Thank you for your Father. And thank you for dying for us. Amen. Certain times, we get caught up in the glories that we have in Jesus, and it can appear that we're arrogant in that. We're not. Because the King that we serve is a King who served by giving his life. And not just giving his life, as Paul says in Philippians, but humbling himself even to death on a cross, the most hated form of death that a person could give at that time. Oh, kneel me down again here at your feet. Show me how much you love humility. Oh, Spirit, be the star that leads me to the humble heart of love I see in you. 'Cause you are the God of the broken, friend of the weak. You wash the feet of the weary, embrace the ones in need. I want to be like you, Jesus. Have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. Oh, kneel me down again here at your feet. Show me how much you love humility. Oh, Spirit, be the star that leads me to the humble heart of love I see. You are the God of the broken, the friend of the weak. You wash the feet of the weary, embrace the ones in need. I want to be like you, Jesus, to have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. Yes, you are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. Oh, kneel me down again here at your feet.
Wow.
Well, it used to be a clean handkerchief. Without disrespect to the scriptures, I oftentimes tell people I have the spiritual gift of phlegm. It's not in the major lists. This next song is a bit rowdy, too. My apologies for those of you who came into church to be solemn today. Hopefully you'll be able to just kind of, this song's a bit rowdy, but hopefully you'll be able to just kind of relax and enjoy it. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days have been held in your hands. The moment that I wake up, till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running out, it's running after me. Your goodness is running out, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, give you everything. Your goodness is running after, running after me.
Take it up.
Your goodness is running after, running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Oh, all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. In our Sunday evening study, we've been kind of going through, slowly, through the life of Abraham. And one of the things, I know that Abraham sang this song. He might have not have sung it with the instrumentation, might have not have sung it with the beat, but I know that he sang this song because he could testify all his life God had been faithful to him. Every single time, whether Abraham was faithful or not faithful, God was faithful the whole time. And I appreciate Ted's sermon talking about just exactly where Abram was, and Abraham later, after God changed his name, where he was in his walk of faith. And during that time, God just continues to pour out his faithfulness. So we're about to go to break. For those of you who are doing the children's classes, are there children's classes this morning? There are children's classes this morning. Terry's giving me the thumbs up. So Terry's got, just go see Terry and Lisa if you have kids. They'll take care. No, they have plans made. Anyway, I'd like to do this chorus one more time. And I'd like to do it not just to honor God who is faithful, Jesus Christ who has been faithful every day of his life and still faithfully intercedes for us in heaven right now as we're speaking. God is up in Jesus is up in heaven going, yeah, I don't understand Randy either, God, but I still love him. And he's pouring out his intercession for us here. During this time, the Spirit intercedes for us. And I'd like us to just acknowledge, but I'd also like us to acknowledge that God has been faithful to lots and lots of people. God has been faithful to Abraham. God's been faithful to a lot of people around us. And just as an acknowledgement of that, that we would honor God and honor those who have walked in faith before us. So if you could maybe just, if you wouldn't mind, since we're going to go to break anyway, you're going to have to get up at that point. So if you can get up, could you please get up? And we'll try to sing this song. Like I said, a great deal more passion than talent. All my life you have been faithful. All my life. This is that really, really old song, like written 200 years ago, that we do in sort of modern style. Anyway. Praise the Savior, you who know. Tell how much we owe him. Gladly let us render to him all we are and have. Jesus is the name that charms us. He for conflict fits and arms us. Nothing moves and nothing harms us while we trust in him. Trust in him, you saints, forever. He is faithful, changing never. Neither force nor God can sever those he loves from him. Keep us, Lord, oh, keep us cleaving to yourself and still believing till the hour our receiving promised joys with you. Then we shall be where we would be. Then we shall be what we should be. Things that are not now nor could be soon shall be
our own. Things that are not now nor could be soon shall be our own. Praise the Savior, you who know him, who can tell how much we owe him. Gladly let us render to him all we are and have. Gladly let us render to him all we are and have. Gladly let us render to him all we are and have.
Amen. All right. Thank you very, very much, worship team. Another great job. good, stirring music, worship music this morning. Eh? It was just great. Appreciate it. Just wanted to lots of other announcements that we need to make here, so I'll just quickly go through it here. I was talking to April Masu. You may recall maybe about a month ago we had that issue in Tonga where there's a volcano, and the water kind of wiped out a lot of the island and whatever. And amazingly, not many people. I'm not sure if anybody died in that situation, but it was just a lot of damage done. And they wanted to give you an update. They couldn't be here today, but April said that she did up a newsletter on the Conversation Church page. So if you want to find out what's happening recently, you can go there. And they do want to thank you for your love and support. So that's good. There's also lots of things happening. Phone directory, we're trying to get up a new phone directory, so the list is in the back there. If you want to change anything or add your name because you're not on it, that would be the perfect opportunity. It's going to be there for another week or two, I guess. And just a reminder again, thanks, Sue, to make that announcement that we're having this super Easter luncheon. Sign-up lists are on the front there, and that'll be, I think it's April 17th, isn't it? Easter is April 17th, so we got lots of time, but we like to make sure we have enough food coming in and whatever, so that's going to be a great feast for sure. Remember, next Sunday, spring ahead, fall behind, 1 hour, we lose 1 hour of sleep. Wow, so just a reminder for next Sunday to have to come here a little hour earlier than you normally would, and if you're a little more crabbier than usual, we'll understand, that's for sure. All right. Do want to, just go to prayer here. We do remember, I'm not sure if you realize or not, but Anna Price, whom we've been praying for, passed away last Sunday night. Just want to remember the family, Kelly and Debbie and the family at this time as they make plans. And it's a time of grief, of course, for them. So please let them remember them in prayer. And also, of course, what's going on in Ukraine. It's just a worldwide, everyone's in uproar, and a lot of concern, a lot of suffering, and you know, it's something we need to bring before God, because we are the church, and our prayers make a difference, and God has the final word in everything in this world, so we want to pray about that too. So let's just pray briefly before we go to the message. Father, we do thank you that you are a God of love, and that we can pray for each other, and we know that, Lord, there are many people who are even our congregation who is suffering in different ways, but we do want to uphold the Price family at this time with the passing of Anna. What a lovely lady she was, and what a beautiful light she was. And so our hearts go out to the family at this time. Be their strength. Lord, we do want to pray for what's going on in Ukraine. We thank you that we're the church, that we have the Spirit of God. We have authority in Jesus' name, and we can call out to you in our pain. And there are so many people who are suffering and such fear in the world. We pray that you would address that in your sovereign love, and that you would protect, that you would move in ways to alleviate what's going on here with the powers behind the scenes, Lord. You know, and you are sovereign over all, and we ask that you would move at this time. We thank you that we can have a peace and rest in you, because our security is in you and your love. And that, we just want to thank you for that. But we just pray for the world at this time that you would move. And Lord God, we just now put your anointing upon the message as we prepare our hearts for communion, Lord. And we just want to thank you for all the grace and love that you give to us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We're doing a sermon series and Church Alive, and this is the third one. It's called The Messiah Spirit. And I'm going to read for you just some of the portion of Acts 2, 22 to 36, not all the verses, but some of them as our scripture reading at this time. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him. You yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Well, God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, yet he said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. As I say, we're doing a series called Church Alive from Acts chapter 2. And we're looking at what happened on the Jewish holy day called Pentecost that occurred 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus. Now, Pentecost was the day that for the first time in history, the life and power of God entered in the hearts of human beings. Jesus said, you must be born again. Flesh gives flesh to flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. And this event was accompanied by miraculous signs like roaring wind and tongues of fire and supernatural speech in foreign languages. And all who received that life from God were automatically united to each other in a family called the church, or the body of Christ. Now, last week we looked at verses 14 to 21, where Peter spoke to crowds of thousands from nations all around the world who were there for Pentecost. And he quoted the prophet Joel as saying that these were the last days when God would begin to intervene on earth to save humanity. God's spirit and power would be poured out onto anyone who would receive it. And it would indeed be accompanied by great wonders and signs. And when people receive God's life, they would interact with each other with God's life. And we would build each other up with the life of God. So that's what the Spirit of God does for us when we receive him. But now we want to look at Peter as he's shifting gears and is telling the crowd how it is that such an incredible event could have happened. I mean, what makes all this possible? Why is it different? Why has it changed? Our passage in Acts 22 to 36, I think answers that question. And if we had to answer that question using just one word, what made the difference? What happened? If we had to use just one word, I think that word would be Jesus. Jesus has made all this possible. But how? What did he do? Well, let's begin with verse 22. Israelites, listen to this. Peter began his speech to all these people, thousands, by saying, listen to this. Now shifting gears, now listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. So the first thing we need to know is that Jesus was a man. I taught an adult school class in Langley back in the 1980s, started actually 1980-81 or whatever. That's a long time ago. Most of you weren't born then, I guess. I don't know. But anyhow, I was just teaching a class, and I was talking about how Jesus was, you know, had the power of God, you know, with him, so he was able to do this and that, the other thing. And someone in a class, an adult person in a class, who actually was a rep for Prairie Bible Institute, it was called at that time, and he was there, he was a rep for BC. He said, well, wait a minute, isn't Jesus God? Can't he do anything he wants anyhow? He's God. Why does he need the power of God to help him? And I thought, well, that's a good question. And I can't remember exactly what I said, but here's kind of some of the things I probably said. My memory's not that good, you know. Here we go. John 1:1-14. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's talking about Jesus, right? And the Word, Jesus, became flesh and made his dwelling, or tabernacled among us. That's talking about, that's God language, God tabernacles, right? Jesus tabernacled among us in his human body. We have seen his glory. So there's no question that Jesus was both God and man. And we call that the doctrine of the incarnation, God becoming flesh. But the question is, when Jesus as God came to earth as a man, did he function as man or as God? Well, my understanding is that though Jesus was God while on earth, he functioned as a man. And Paul said this about Jesus in Philippians chapter 2, 6-7, a very famous verse. I got it from the ESV this time. Who though he was, talking about Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born, you know, through Virgin Mary, right? Being born in the likeness of men. Well, Jesus himself said in John 5:19, very truly I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. Wait a minute. God can do anything by himself, right? But the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing. That Jesus, as a man, was totally obedient to God's authority and totally dependent on God's power. And that's how a human being should function and relate to God, of course. Now, Jesus was a very special man, however. He wasn't just like an ordinary kind of man, right? He was the only human being who ever had been born without sin, because, of course, his Father was God. He was born perfect. And he was the only human being that lived his entire life without sinning, right? Scriptures always emphasize that. He was everything that God wanted a human being to be when he first created us. He was God's only perfect man who has ever lived. And when Jesus was baptized, he received the Spirit power from God so that he could dependently live for God. And God called down from heaven and said, at last, this is the man I've been looking for. Matthew 3:16-17. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water, and at that moment, heaven was open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. So Peter tells us in Acts 2:22, here it is again, I'm just quoting it, Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him. Now, to be accredited, of course, means to be endorsed by a recognized authority, like, is this an accredited college? You know, that kind of thing, eh? God said, this is my perfect man, and I endorse him by doing miracles, wonders, and signs through him. That was God's way of saying, this is my man. This is my man. So Jesus is the only human being who has ever been accredited, approved, and accepted by God. Boom, approved. He is the only human who has the authority and power to save the rest of humanity. And you know, the whole, you know, what you might say, well, why, you know, why does God need a human being to save humanity? Why doesn't God just kind of operate by himself? Well, the reason is because God made this earth and said, let man have dominion over it and rule over all of it. He delegated authority to mankind over the earth. Isaiah, Psalm 115:16 says, the highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to mankind. But the problem was, what did Adam and Eve do with the keys and the authority that they had on earth? What did they do with it? They turned it over to Satan. Satan deceived them, and they bowed, as it were, to Satan. Satan took the keys, and now the New Testament even says that right now the god of this world, as far as practical day-to-day things, is Satan. So no wonder we're in a mess. Would you agree? And the God's on a rescue mission. He has to be on a rescue mission because the world's in a mess. And that's why Jesus came to earth. He came to earth to rescue. He had to come to earth as a man because man gave away the authority. Man's got to get it back. God's up there saying, nope, I'm in heaven, you're on earth. Man messed it up. Man's got to fix it up. So he became a man to fix it up. Amen. Right? And so that's what happened. And Jesus was born into earth as a man. And Jesus is battling. He was given the assignment by God the Father. He's battling to wrestle back the authority from Satan to mankind as a man before God, so we can worship God the way we should. That's my understanding. You can say, well, I've never heard that before. That's okay. But that's my understanding. No other human being has been or ever will be endorsed by God. Right? Jesus is the only one. If we want to become acceptable and approved by God through our own good behavior, like every other religion in the world, we can go right ahead. If we think we are better than sinners, we can go right ahead and believe that. But as for me and my house, I have nothing to give to God except my faith in Jesus. He is the perfect man who represents me before God. He is my mediator and my intercessor. And I put my trust in him. Because Jesus is the only way to be acceptable and approved by God. Peter then goes on to explain how it is that Jesus can make us acceptable and approved by God. Well, how does it work? Well, here's what he says in Acts 2:23. That's the next verse in our scripture. This perfect man, that's the implication, right? This perfect man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. Wow. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. A chaplain in prison was giving a lecture or sermon or Bible study or whatever to some people. And he asked the question to the prisoners that were gathered there, who killed Jesus? And this is a true story as far as I know. And one said, the Roman soldiers killed Jesus. Another said, well, the Jews, I think, killed Jesus, really. And another much wiser prisoner said, we all killed Jesus because it was our sins that killed him. And to their shock, the chaplain said, no, you're all wrong. His own father killed him. God killed Jesus. This perfect man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan foreknowledge. Nobody could touch Jesus unless God planned to be that way. Now, why would God plan before the beginning of time to have his son, who was the only perfect and acceptable human being who ever lived, to be handed over to human beings to be killed? Well, you know, we don't have all the words that Peter preached to them on the day of Pentecost. You know, Acts 2 is just a brief outline of the kind of things that Peter said to them. I mean, I don't think that was the full sermon. Right? I mean, I read it through and it took me 2.5 minutes. Do you think he preached a powerful sermon that transformed 3,000 people in 2.5 minutes? Probably not. Probably not. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, you know, they just give you the outline, right? So I suspect that Peter went into more detail at this point to explain why the innocent Jesus was handed over to people to be killed. But we know this, for example, here's a good verse from Paul that explains why this had to happen. It's a good summary. God, in 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who had no sin, that's emphasized again, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Paul is saying that Jesus was the only perfect and acceptable human being, and he literally became sin. Every single sin that humanity has done to others, and has been done to us by others, was placed onto Jesus on the cross. He became sin. He was so saturated with sin that he became sin. He became the most evil. Look at, I hope you understand the way what I'm saying here. But really, if all the sins of humanity were zeroed in on Jesus while he was on the cross, is it not true that at that point in time, he became the most evil human being in history? He carried all the sin of humanity. My God, why have you forsaken me? And because the wages of sin is death, he died. He died. But not because of his sins, but because of our sins. This has left humanity clean and innocent before God. We become the righteous. We become the righteousness of God if we humbly surrender and accept this undeserved act of love and grace from God. We might call this the great exchange. It's a wonderful, it's the gospel, really. It's powerful news. Best news I've ever heard. We give God all our sin, the whole works. And he takes it. And he gives us, Jesus gives us his total righteousness. Pure, 100%. The great exchange. Right? Isn't that powerful? I think it's powerful. Good news as far as I'm concerned. I don't deserve, who deserves it? Nobody? Right? Nobody. Nobody deserves that. That's the grace of God. That's the gospel, good news. And by the way, we don't try to become righteous. We learn to live out of the righteousness that God has already given to us. That's another sermon series. How do you walk in the Spirit, right? How do you walk in the Spirit? Anyhow, Paul says elsewhere that Jesus right now is the mediator between God and humanity. So I'm just sort of picturing something here. Jesus appears before God, the judge, and says, Your Honor, Ted has put his trust in me as his representative man. He has given me his sins, past, present, and future, and I have given him my perfection. And God says, Good! He is now acceptable to me and approved by me also. 1 Timothy 2, verses 3 to 6, a very well-known verse, I think. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. And that's the truth that we're talking about. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man. Jesus is still a man, right? The man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. And then Peter goes on to say in Acts 2:24, that the proof that God has accepted the sacrifice of Jesus for our sins is that he didn't stay dead. God raised him from the dead. God accepted the death of Jesus on our behalf. It's been accepted. Praise God. Since the price of our sins has been paid, death could not hold him. Acts 2:24, but God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep his hold on him. Isn't that amazing? He's in the grave, death strikes, no, you're not going to, no. And no, he defeated death because sin had been paid for, and that's the only thing that death had authority over us. It's our sin. When a sin's paid for, no more authority. I think that's cool. I think that's really cool. Then we see in Acts 2:25-28, which I won't spend much time on, Peter quotes King David, from Psalm 16:8-11, where David predicts that one of his ancestors, would one day be the promised Messiah king, and he would be raised from the dead. And then Peter says this in Acts 2:30. But he, David, was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Now, you know, this is the promised Messiah king that related, descended from David. The scriptures say a lot about this. For example, Isaiah 9, 6 to 7, this is like a Christmas passage. We'll talk about Christmas, getting close to Easter, but let's talk about Christmas first. Isaiah said this super king would rule on David's throne and bring eternal peace to the entire world. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Isn't that a good thing right now? Here's what it says, Isaiah 9, 6 to 7. I've heard this verse before. No, that's just keep on listening. It's wonderful verses. For to us a child is born. That's when Jesus was born. To us a son is given, the Son of God. And the government will be on his shoulders. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. Wow. Everlasting Father. Yikes. Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. When does the peace of Jesus stop when he starts? Never. He will reign, here it is, he will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And when we are told that this super Messiah, two chapters later in Isaiah, we're told that this super Messiah king will be anointed or coronated as king by the Spirit of God. It says in Isaiah 11, 1 to 2, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, that's David's father, from David. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. Finally, a king that's going to produce fruit, total fruit. And it says here, the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. You see, the kings of Israel were not coronated by having... they were not coronated by just having a crown put on their head, as pictured here with, I think that's Queen Elizabeth there, which happened, 70 years ago now? 60, 70 years ago. They were coronated as king by God when God anointed them with his Spirit. That's how they were coronated. This receiving of the Spirit was symbolized by pouring oil on their heads. And this is similar to what happened to King David himself. When he was coronated as king by Samuel, after Saul was rejected, as pictured here in that picture. It's a horn of oil that Samuel is pouring onto young David. We read this, and this is important, that's why I'm reading it. The Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul since I've rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil, and on your way I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king. And then verse 13. So Samuel took the horn of oil, and he's going to do it for David now. He took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Again, the word, the anointing oil represented the Spirit of God coming down upon the king. It's all symbolic, right? Now, this is important. I want to emphasize this. The word Messiah means the anointed one, right? With oil and Spirit, the anointed one. This was the way that a man was coronated as a king in Israel. All kings, in that sense, all kings were messiahs or anointed ones. But everyone was looking forward to the ultimate Messiah who would bring peace to the entire earth forever. And I think we're still looking for that day. Anyhow, Peter at this point emphasizes again that David predicted the resurrection of the Messiah. Acts 2:31-32. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay, but God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Now, by the way, here's another important thing I think you need to realize. Most Bible translations use the word Christ instead of Messiah. But Christ is just the Greek form of Messiah. They both words mean the anointed one. So, when you see the words Jesus Christ, it means, like, Christ is not the last name of Jesus, right? Oh, hello, Mr. Christ, would you like to have, you know, a seat? No, no. Christ is not the last name of Jesus. It's his title, Messiah. It means Jesus Christ means Jesus the Messiah, or Jesus in his full sense, Jesus the promised anointed king who will save the world. That's what Jesus Christ means in his full sense. Anyhow, Peter said something very incredible. Okay, we're going to get some really good stuff here. So don't go to sleep yet. It is very important to see this, because if you are a believer in Jesus, it directly relates to you and to me and to our church in a very profound way. So are you ready? Here's something very shocking that he says. Here it is. Acts 2, 33 and 36. Exalted to the right hand of God, he, Jesus, has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit. That's the anointing. And, look at this, has poured out what you now see and hear. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Did you catch what's being said here? It's a little bit breathtaking, to be honest. When Jesus went to heaven 40 days after his resurrection, at some point, he was exalted to the right hand of God's throne. That means he was coronated as the promised Messiah King. God made him Lord and Messiah. Now, how did Jesus get coronated? He was anointed by God with the promised Holy Spirit. He received the promised Holy Spirit from God. Jesus has been given the authority and power to rule for God as his king, to bring peace between humanity and God, so there can be peace between humanity itself. We need that too, of course. There can be no peace between us until we first have peace with God. Obviously, the world hasn't figured that one out yet. But here's what is absolutely incredible and mind-boggling. What is the first thing Jesus did when he received the Spirit that anointed him as king? What's the first thing he did? It says he poured out that same Messiah Spirit onto his followers. He has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. The day of Pentecost, listen, the day of Pentecost not only represents the day that the Spirit of God was given to us, it was also the day when the Spirit was first given to Jesus. It was the day that Jesus was officially coronated as the anointed Messiah King to save the world. But Jesus never wanted to rule as King of Kings all by himself. You know, he qualified to take it back as a human being. He didn't want to keep it for himself, did he? He is so generous and so humble that he wanted to share and delegate that same Spirit, authority, and power with other human beings who put their trust in him as their perfect representative. So he said, this is Jesus speaking, in my words, of course, look, I am ruling in heaven as King of Kings now, but until I return to earth to complete my assignment, I want you to administer my rule for me on earth. I am the head, but you will be my body. You will be the body of Christ, or the body of the Messiah, King on earth. Your prayers will activate my authority, and I will empower you wherever you go to advance my kingdom of peace on earth. No wonder there was such a fireworks display, like roaring sound of a storm and flashy lights coming down from heaven on the day of Pentecost. No wonder. The eternal King of Kings had just been enthroned and coronated, and he wanted us to join in on the celebrations since we too received that same anointing. When Jesus saves us, he doesn't just forgive us and give us his life. That's fantastic, wonderful. He also enthrones us with him by giving us his messianic spirit. We are forgiven through his death, we are born again through his resurrection life, and we are empowered for his mission to this troubled world by his coronation. Paul put it this way in Ephesians 1 and 2, and I'm getting close to the end here. And verses 18 and 19, he starts this way. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ, the anointed king, from the dead, and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule, authority, power, and dominion. That power, he says, that did that, that anointing that did that for Jesus, is the same as the one he's going to give to us. In verses 19 to 20. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him above all things. I think I missed it. I didn't miss 18 and 19, didn't I? I read the wrong thing. Sorry, I messed up there. I pray, he starts this way. I pray, as it goes backwards, or go back to verse 18 and 19. I missed that. My apologies. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. Paul's saying, you guys don't really get it. These were, Ephesians were great Christians, but they just didn't really get it. He says, I pray that your eyes will be open to see the kind of incomparably great power for us who believe. And then he says in verses 19 to 20, then he says, that power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead. Same power. Same power that seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all authority, power, and dominion. Same power. And God, it says, he goes on to say in verses 22 to 23, God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church. Jesus has all this authority as the representative man, the Messiah, for us, which is his body. We're the body of the Messiah, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. And then he says in chapter 2, verse 6, and God raised us up with Jesus, with the anointed king, and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. I don't know, that's pretty strong language. So here's my conclusion. Do we believe that we are now seated with the anointed king on his throne? Do we believe that we are the body of the Messiah king and that he has filled us with his anointed Messiah spirit? Do we believe that we are the feet and hands on earth of the Messiah, the head in heaven? Do we believe that we have the authority and power of the Messiah to advance his kingdom here on earth? Do our prayers make any difference? The spirit that we received at salvation is the Messiah spirit. It is the spirit of Christ. And do we believe these last words of Jesus in John 20, 21 to 22? Jesus said this, as the Father sent me, that's his Messiah mission, right? I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. That's the Messiah spirit, and that's church alive. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the things that seem too good to be true. That you took all our sins and gave us your righteousness, Lord Jesus. You made us perfect in God's sight, though we are not perfect. You made us acceptable, though we're not acceptable in our own strength. And all we can say is thank you for that incredible grace. And we're going to remember it now in communion. And Lord, you've also given us the authority. You've restored the authority to humanity, right? You said rule over the earth, and you did it through Jesus. You've given it to us. And all we can say is thank you for your generous, generous grace. We do give you praise and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 This song makes me think of a song written by somebody who's maybe a little bit objectionable to a lot of the church, especially the theme of what the song was written for. But this particular person, at one point in his life, testified, I was blinded by the devil, born already ruined, stone cold dead as I stepped out of the womb. By his grace I have been touched, by his hand I have been healed, by his spirit I've been delivered, by his spirit I've been sealed, and I've been saved by the blood of the Lamb. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door. Knock, knock, knocking on heaven's door.
light of the world, you stepped down into darkness. Open my eyes and let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So I can trade these ashes in. And wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross, as I look into your word, ponder your thoughts, read it once again. Lord, I am in awe that you gave your life for me. Oh, help me to know why. Tell me of the cross, tell me again. You paid such a cost, bearing my sin. Lord, when I was lost, you came for me. Tell me of the cross, tell me of the cross again.
We're going to partake in communion as we do on the first Sunday of every month to remember our Lord's sacrifice for us and the forgiveness of sins, a wonderful, wonderful gift. I just want to read as we reflect on the the bread right now. The bread represents many things. It represents the broken body of Jesus Christ, but also represents sort of ingesting his life. And we're talking about the life of God in us. And Jesus said in John 6, 48 to 51, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone can eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Let's pray as the men will be handing out and I want to mention again, this is for most of you, maybe some of you have never been here before when we do this. It's a new way of doing communion. It's one element. The bread's on top. You have to rip off the top first, and you have the bread. And then when you rip off the next layer, then you can drink the juice. So just we'll just be handing out once and be doing it together probably at this time. But let me pray for the bread, and then it'll be distributed. Dear Father God, we do thank you for the bread of life that came down from heaven. We thank you that it's not just something we can admire, that we can actually eat, and it can become a part of us in our hearts, the life of God, the life of Jesus. And Jesus, you were broken on the cross for our sins. That's why the bread is broken. But you broke it so that we could have it and be a part of you in Christ and Christ in us. We want to just thank you for that now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
King of all days, O so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, and all for love's sake you became poor. At the foot of the cross, where grace and suffering meet, you have shown me your love through the judgment you receive. You won my heart, you won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty and wear forgiveness. Coming to kiss the feet of mercy, I lay every burden down. I lay every burden down at the foot of the cross.
Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" I think we'll just go right into taking the cup at this time. I just wanted to mention that verse in 2 Corinthians 5 is just so powerful, isn't it? He who had no sin became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God. And that's so hard for us to believe, isn't it? That God would extend that kind of grace to us through the blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. But let me just pray for the juice right now, which represents that powerful, powerful truth, the gospel. I would just like to pray for that right now, if I could, and then we will, and then I'll read and we can take it. Father, thank you for the juice which represents the spilt blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's hard for us to realize what that sacrifice means, how much it costs, how much it means for us. But Lord, if we can just even see it just a bit more even today, what you've done for us, may it soften our hearts. May we just live more in praise and glory to you, because indeed you are worthy. And we thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Then I just want to read in 1 Corinthians, Paul said, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And all God's people said, "Amen." Amen.
When you hung there on the tree, Lord, you were alone. You faced the power of death to bring me home. As I think about your love, Lord, how the tears they flow. Tell me of the cross, tell me again. You paid such a cost, bearing my sin. Lord, when I was lost, you came for me. Tell me of the cross. so highly exalted. Glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created. All for love's sake became at the foot of the cross. Where I am made complete. You have given me life through the death you bore for me. And you won my heart. Yes, you won my heart. Now I can trade these ashes in for beauty and wear forgiveness like a crown, coming to kiss the feet of mercy. I lay every burden down, lay every burden down. I lay every burden, I lay every burden. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow, here I am to say, you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship.
Lord Jesus Christ, Master of the universe, Creator, for whom, through whom, and by whom all heaven and earth was made and exists, we cry out to you, Lord Jesus, may you be exalted. May you be exalted in our lives as we step out from this place, that we would never look back, but we would follow you. Lead on, King Eternal. Amen. You're dismissed.